programme this week comes from Holland. We're at the Dutch Floriade, which is their big gardening event, which they hold just once every 10 years. And it's packed with good ideas. Here, for example, look at how they've woven these plants into a wonderful tapestry of colour. And do bear in mind that, unlike Chelsea, these are permanent gardens. This is for real. So you really could use this in your own garden.
No wonder Floriade takes place just once every 10 years, because that's how long it takes to grow it. And even then, nature needs a little helping hand in order for the site to be full of mature and semi-mature trees and shrubs. The site is enormous. You need really comfortable shoes here. It's well over 200 acres of what? It's not exactly a flower show. It's more of a theme park, and the theme is gardens. It's an opportunity for growers and nationalities to get together with all their ideas and to express them through gardens.
Of course, like our own garden festivals, there are some parts of it that are totally incomprehensible. This, for example, is the Garden of the Flowering of Youth. The Austrian garden is nothing short of weird. But if you want an instant living fence, this is a brilliant idea. These are just oversized cuttings of willow. They're shoved in at an angle and loosely woven together. And I should say that if you did these fresh in the winter, you'd get 100% take. And if you've got a bit of wet and heavy land, I reckon they grow like the clappers.
As well as that innovative fence, Floriade have planted 4,500 trees, 70,000 shrubs, more than 1 million bulbs, and 500,000 other plants. But all that won't be wasted when Floriade's over. Most of the showground's destined to become parkland for a newly built housing estate. Residents might well be able to enjoy wandering through areas like this lush artificial valley. Geoff talked to its designer.
Now, this place is called the Green Valley, and a valley it is, but why?
No, I think there are two reasons. One of the reasons you can see today, there's a lot of wind in this area. We are not far from the sea, about 10 kilometers. And now we created a valley because of the microclimate. Microclimate for the plants, perennials, and bulbs, but also for the visitors. And now we are staying here. We feel the wind is gone, and we are now in the valley. And I think that's one of the important reasons. The second reason is that we did like to create a garden of a smaller scale, a much smaller scale than the big exhibition, so that it's possible for the visitors to be away and from that whole exhibition.
It does feel actually very quiet and peaceful here, doesn't it? And you've used quite a lot of concrete in very strong lines.
Yeah, that's right, quite a lot. We use concrete to create, we call it a red line, to give the garden a body.
Well, why have you used these concrete slabs here?
These slabs, we use them because at this point we would like the people, the visitors, that they bended their heads and had a view in one of the most beautiful parts of this garden, the water area.
One of the things that is really attracting people about the water feature is this superb bronze fountain. Now, you've got a lot of bronzes in the garden.
Yeah, indeed. After finishing planting 3 months ago, we missed something. Of course, the garden is full of beautiful bulbs and perennials and trees, but we missed something exciting. At that moment, I met some artists, and they created in this garden about 15 statues and fountains. And I'm very happy with that, because the combination of this statue, this fountain, with the plants is, I think, is in a very good good feeling,
yes,
and people appreciate it.
They
also
make all the difference, don't they?
Yeah,
somehow.
Yeah, indeed.
One of the interesting things that I've just noticed about this fountain is that you've got the water coming up through a sort of copper pipe or something, and it's moved around with a simple bolt stuck in the top.
It's a bolt which is used for connecting the seat belt in your car to the car, and to find this one, it's very difficult.
Well,
but it works perfect.
Absolutely.
Because
perfect.
It's twinkling, it's turning around.
Lovely, isn't it? Now, a bit further down here, you've got a wonderful display of lilies. People often think of the Dutch as selling tulips and this sort of thing, but of course they do actually sell the whole range, don't they?
Yeah, that's right. Of course there are a lot of tulips, hyacinths and daffodils, but that's one of the reasons of this green valley, to show the people the summer flowering bulbs. And you can see at this moment the lilies are flowering, what an enormous effect in color that has.
It's obviously much better to plant these in big drifts rather than singly.
Yeah, I think it depends on the scale of your garden, of course, but in this garden we have room enough. In combination with the larger amount of green, you need at the moment also a larger amount of color.
You've also, I think, got a wonderful effect with the planting of lilies with those red foliage plants.
Yeah, that's again one of the starting points, to show the people the combination between the bulbs, the plants and the shrubs. And we have red flowering lilies with the red leaves of the prunus, and this gives a very special combination.
Well, I think, Niek, the whole valley really is special, and quite obviously the public are enjoying it immensely, aren't they?
Bleached limes, or lindens, are a Dutch tradition. They were planted around the outside of farmhouses so that the shade above didn't obscure the view below. And of course, they were very space-saving in a small country because the bare trunks didn't take up nearly as much room as a hedge would have. Well, the idea soon spread throughout Europe. In Britain, it became a feature of the country house garden. That was at a time when suntans were considered rather vulgar. Well, now that we know the dangers of tanning, I shouldn't be at all surprised if pleaching or tree training makes something of a comeback, because it's a very space-saving way of creating some shade in your garden. It's quite easy to do, although it does take a while, and you need to start when the tree is still fairly young. When the leader's got up to about here, in other words, it's got laterals at the point where you want your hedge to start, you simply train them out and tie them down. Now, I see that at Floriade they've used bamboo, quite good thick bamboo, and that's a good idea because it's going to have to last for quite a few years. You let your leader grow on up, and after about 2 feet, you train your next lot of laterals down again, and so on, and so on, and so on. And you have to cut off all the bits that you don't want, of course. But you don't have to train your lime trees upwards. It's another great Dutch tradition to train them horizontally, and the result is a really lovely green canopy. We've had some blistering weather here at Floriade, and this has been a godsend, as a matter of fact. If you want to try it at home, there are two possible problems. The first is that lime trees can attract aphids, and they cause droppings. And you can get round this by choosing the species Petiolaris. The second snag is that it takes rather a long time. These trees are 15 to 20 years old, and that's how long it's going to take you to achieve something like this in Britain. Of course, if you live in Holland, you can buy them ready trained from an enterprising nurseryman.
This is the watery part of the Floriade, and in typical Dutch tradition, this canal takes water right the way round this part of the site. And it contains quite a large proportion of the Dutch National Collection of water lilies. There are hundreds of plants here, and the sides have been planted with marginal plants and bog plants too. So if you're planning a water feature in your own garden, you can get lots of ideas here. All you've got to do is reduce it down a bit. But if the scale is still too big for you, how about this then? There are a whole series here of concrete bowls making little tiny pools. But I have to say that this wouldn't really work as a long-term prospect. It's just a way of displaying water lilies. The lilies would soon outgrow their space and the water would go cloudy. Here they cheat a bit by changing it every couple of days. But if you were to grow a wider diversity of plants, including some oxygenating weed, and you were to sink the bowl in the ground to keep the water cool, then it would make a super little pool and the water would stay clear. These little gardens are really delightful, and what a good idea. You take a square stone or concrete trough, you put in it a round plastic tub, and you fill around with heavy soil. You fill the tub with water and grow aquatic plants in that, and in the heavy soil on the outside you grow bog plants. You have to appreciate, of course, that in this case the bog garden would not be fed from the pond, so you'd have to top it up from time to time, but you'd soon get used to how much you needed. You might also like to replace some of the plants occasionally. These primulas, for instance, look very good now, but when they go out of flower, you could take them out, divide them, pot them up ready for next year, and replace them with something else. This houghtonia, I'm not so sure I would recommend normally for a bog garden because it's such a rampant grower that it would choke out anything else. But here, of course, you would grow it in its pot. And provided it was in a sunny position, you get this lovely three-coloured variegation right the way through the summer.
One garden which is attracting a tremendous amount of attention here at Floriade is, and I say this without bias, the British garden. The designer is James Wilson.
One always thinks of a garden as something that evolves. Either one goes to Chelsea, in which case there are those who are magnificent in producing a garden that lasts 4 days. We've got a garden here that has to last for 6 months, but it has to look good on the 9th of April and the 10th of April whenever it opened. It has to look good all the way through to the middle of October when it closes.
James Wilson wanted to design a garden that was truly British.
Britain is a nation of gardeners. And what could be more appropriate than a garden which is full of a series of sequences, of views, of different cameos, really, which represent gardening in a country which, unlike Holland, has got such a history of fascinating plants in art and craft. So we have a garden here which has got four different perspectives on British gardens. Knowing that the majority of people would come towards the British garden from the main entrance, we decided that the first impact had to be a summer garden. The summer garden has the feature of the orangery. And the orangery is set off by a lovely piece of lawn. No English British garden is without its lawn. From there, we have a rose garden, which is just behind us here, and there, where else is there but roses and arches and arbors and things and pastel shades of roses in that part of the garden. The pool garden which we're now in is really meant to be an antithesis to that in as much as it's full of color. Dark green and white principally because background is so important when you're talking about showing off other colors. So the plants that you see here are mostly dark green and with white flowers, but then splashes of red and yellow which you'll see are totally unlike those in the rose garden. And then finally, we have our small kitchen garden. Most British gardens do have their marvelous patch dedicated to growing vegetables. There was a lot of concern because vegetables require constant attention.
Well, because Floriade lasts 6 months, it wasn't just in the vegetable garden that workers were wanted. But help was at hand.
There are five of us on a small committee, supported by many volunteers, and we come on a fairly regular basis and do all the, what I call, tender loving care for the garden, so that it does look as if it is a personal garden rather than an exhibition garden.
Well, we're all volunteers from the British Women's Club, and we've come here to maintain the garden. We all love gardening, and it just keeps the place neat and tidy, as there is a maintenance crew here, but we like to oversee and make sure the British garden is looking the best.
This circular herbaceous garden is open to the sun on all sides, so all the borders get baked. And that, of course, is the first lesson you have to learn about any sort of planting. It's obvious, really, that the sun lovers go in the sun and the shade lovers in the shade, but it does mean that you've got to get to know a little bit about your plants before you plant them. Now, the second obvious lesson is tallest at the back and shortest at the front. But that's a rule that's made to be bent slightly, and they've done it rather well here by drifting some of the taller plants down towards the front and vice versa to give this interesting variation in height. But then once you've done that, you've got to get your colours right, and that's the difficult bit. What they've done here is to separate the colours of the spectrum so that they don't really clash, and then they've drifted one gently into another. Here, for example, they start with the yellows, with this Alcamilla mollis here, backed by the yellow Jerusalem sage, and in the front, several achilleas here. It was a time, of course, when all achilleas were very bright yellow, but now there are lots of different varieties. And gradually, gradually in creep the very pale purples with this Astrantia maxima, down to deeper purple of this Thalictrum, lovely foliage here, and then the really strong colour of the leaves of Heuchera palis purple. And the reason for this is because now we're getting into the blues. And what blues they are! A stand of almost navy blue delphiniums at the back there, fronted by blue salvias, and then right down tumbling over the edge are these Veronica. What a marvellous show it makes. Because of Vita Sackville West's marvellous garden at Sissinghurst Castle, white borders have enjoyed being in the fashion for some time. But because there's no colour, they could be rather boring. So here and there, they've really hit you in the eye with a contrasting red from this geum. And gradually the whites drift into the warm colours, the reds and the crimsons, until finally you get down to colours like this orange mimulus, which are really so bright that they're difficult to put with anything. So they've planted them with other startling colours like this really bright red Lychnis arkwrightii and let them fight it out together.
The Dutch really love cut flowers and pot plants, as Anne Swithenbank discovered when she went to Amsterdam.
This is Single Market, stretching along the banks of the Single Canal in the centre of the city. And here's where the medieval flower sellers used to tie up their boats in order to sell whatever was in season at the time. Now the moorings are somewhat more permanent, but here you can still find the best of what's in season. And at the moment, it's peonies. Now 10 stems are selling here for about £5, which I think is really good value. You tend not to find things like peonies at home in Britain. And of course the Dutch buy so many cut flower that you can find far more variety here because they can be sure of selling it. And variety is what we've come to see. These Eryngium or sea hollies seem to appear on almost all the flower stands, and I think they must be my favourites. They have such a wonderful silvery blue colour. And they're very long stemmed and will last quite a long time in water as well. Not so keen on these celosia. I think they look a bit like bright, colourful brains. I don't really like those at all. But I do like the Lysianthus or prairie gentian. They're in the same family as gentians, and we've actually started to grow them as pot plants in Britain more than cut flower, but I think they're very good. Something I've been quite surprised to see are the hosta flowers. Now, of course, we grow these mostly as foliage plants back at home, outside in the garden, but rarely notice that they actually come into flower. And I suppose that's rather a bonus if the slugs have eaten all your leaves off. At least you've got some flowers left. If you don't want to choose your own colour combinations, you'll find the florists have actually done it for you and put together all these bouquets, ranging in price from about £3 to just over £5. I love these different blues with trochilium or lungwort and campanulas mixed with these wonderful sort of creamy apricot rosebuds. And here's Bouvardia, which is actually quite an exotic conservatory plant back at home. And here you can see it just as a cut flower. Tremendous range. I think most people are aware that you can bring a couple of bottles of wine back into the country, but when it comes to plant material, there seems to be a certain amount of confusion. Actually, you can take back in 5 plants or cuttings, a small bunch of flowers, and up to 2 kilograms of bulbs, with a few exceptions, if they're coming from Mediterranean and European countries. I'm looking at a group of bulbs here that look rather like massive onions. In fact, they're hippiastrum, sometimes called amaryllis. These are really huge, and they're selling for about £2 for £5, which is really good value. Now, if I was to buy one of these and take it home, I'd want to soak those roots in water for a couple of hours prior to planting so they really plump up. And then when planting, only bury the bulb by half. And if you look after these well, they'll flower brilliantly very soon after planting, and then hopefully year after year after that. Most of the houseplants are cheaper than at home. Some are about two-thirds of the price, some half. I've seen lush, wavy-edged asplenium ferns for £4. Creamy, fragrant-flowered stephanotis for just £2, which is amazing. And plaited weeping figs for £12, and they usually cost a fortune back at home. And if you can't fit one of those in your bag, then what about these miniature St. Paulias, which are only 25p each? I think I might take a few of these home back as presents for friends. As well as being of good value, there are some unusual plants here as well. I'm a great fan of Hoyas or wax flowers, but it's quite irritating because back at home you can only usually find about 3 varieties offered for sale in ordinary garden centres. But here there's a really vast range. I'm particularly excited by Hoya megillivrayi, which has these enormous maroon-coloured flowers, and also by Hoya kerrii. This reminds me of creme brulee because it's got nectar that looks like caramelised sugar about to drip from the flower. And all of these are about £12 each. For £7, you can get a beautiful phalaenopsis or moth orchid. These make really good houseplants, providing you don't overwater them. But on the other hand, there are some beautiful Miltonias, the pansy orchid as well. The whole problem with single market is that you're simply spoilt for choice. And we're having exactly the same problem here at Floriade. But there was one garden which Geoff couldn't resist.
This little garden was created by a Dutch artist, Ter Linden, and his story is fascinating. His first interest in plants arose because he used them for subjects for painting. But he decided that he would quite like to grow some of the things that he painted. Well, he lived in a flat in Amsterdam with no garden at all. So, very frustrated, he bought himself a small house with a tiny garden and started growing a few plants. But as you would have guessed, once he started growing, he got hooked. And he now runs a 2.5-acre garden in Rauden in the north of Holland. That's open to the public, and it's well worth a visit. You can see how his artistic eye has created some superb plant placings. This tall, stately yellow verbascum contrasts perfectly with the silvery foliage of this huge thistle. And the round globes of Allium Globemaster, all of which tower above the lower plantings of Gypsophila down at the bottom there. There are some wonderful plants in this garden, and if you look very closely, you can see that many of them are absolutely covered in bees. And that's no coincidence, because the garden is right next to the bee exhibition. And there you can learn about how to keep bees in your own garden. And you may be surprised to find out that it's not nearly as complicated or as dangerous as you might have thought. Gardens are good for bees, and of course bees are good for gardens because they provide pollination. They're specially imported into this crop of greenhouse strawberries for that very purpose. They come in these little portable hives, and they do a jolly good job of pollination to produce a really bumper crop. There's a lot of interest here for greenhouse gardeners as well. Notice that these strawberries are grown at shoulder level, supported on these pipes. And that's to make picking easy and to keep the fruit off the ground too. This is really, of course, a demonstration of commercial horticulture, but there's a lot here that we gardeners can learn too. I, for example, grow my peppers as a bush, keeping all the side shoots on. But here they're growing them up strings, just like tomatoes, which greatly extends the season and, of course, produces a much bigger crop.
Well, I dragged Geoff along to these extraordinary leaning post things because I think they're a really good alternative to seats and they're surprisingly comfortable.
One of the things that really fascinated me was the way they'd used willow here. We saw the fence, of course, but they'd also made woven willow duck baskets for nesting ducks, which were super. And they take huge cuttings of poplars, about half the size of a telegraph pole. They drive them into the ground where, sure enough, they root, they sprout out at the top, and you've got an instant tree.
At the last Floriade, railway sleepers were used all over the site, and it sparked off a real craze for them in Dutch gardens. Well, this time around, old granite curbstones have been used everywhere for steps and for seats, and now Holland's bracing itself for a new garden fashion.
As you might have guessed, I loved the little environmentally friendly garden, mainly because it was a really good example of a good organic garden. It had flowers and fruit and vegetables in it too. And I particularly liked the way they supported their tomatoes with sort of curly metal stakes. So you didn't actually have to do anything. The tomato just grew up the middle and supported itself. There was also a black podded pea there with some beautiful flowers. It's one I'm going to look out for next year.
In a shady, quiet area of the showground, lumps of old brick wall have been usefully recycled, and I think they look really attractive too.
There are a wealth of international gardens there, from Italy to Indonesia, from Bangladesh to Belgium, and quite a few of them we simply couldn't grow back at home, even if we wanted to. But it did give a very interesting insight into how the other half lived. I particularly like the German garden, not because of the garden, actually, but because with typical German thoroughness, the plants were very well labelled, and I found several there that I'd like to look out, particularly a red penstemon, which I hadn't seen before.
Wild gardens are all the vogue on the continent, as they are in Britain, and there are some really outstanding examples here on various soil types. This one was created 5 years ago by digging hay from orchid-rich meadows into peaty, unnutritious soil and allowing the wildflowers to germinate. But my favourite is this recreation of a barley field of the past. Farmers may shudder, but the barley is grown ornamentally here with wildflowers. The result is an interesting and lovely garden of nostalgia.
There's nothing quite like roses to give you a real sea of colour right the way through the season. If you're a rose enthusiast, you could have a real field day here. But alas, our time is up. We haven't been able to show you nearly the whole of the Floriade, but all the more reason why you should come yourself. Well, next week we visit a tiny city garden, which is a perfect example of how good design can make the very best of a small space. If you're troubled with creepies and crawlies, then Pippa Greenwood will have the answers. And I've got to get back to real life and do some gardening at Barnsdale. Goodbye.
For the summer season with the new BBC Gardeners World magazine. Get the facts on Britain's water shortage and follow BBC Two's water saving tips. Support your local